Welcome everyone to this new webinar. This time we will have Pablo from CINVESTAV. Sorry. Pablo did his PhD in Valencia, and then he moved for a postdoc position in Barcelona, in FAI. Then he went back to Mexico and he did a short postdoc in UNAM. And now he's a researcher in CINVESTAV, that is also in Mexico City. And well, during the webinar, you can make questions in the Google Hangout or through our hashtag, LawP. And okay, then, well, have some people here in the room that will be asking questions after the talk. And well, please go ahead.
Thank you very much, Herman, for hosting this webinar. Also, thanks to all the Latin American webinars team. So now I will put my file on the screen. And you should be seeing it now, is that right?
Yes, now it's going well.
Okay. Yeah. So, okay, good. So I'll be talking about lepton flavor violation in a specific model that is called Simplest Little Higgs Model. This work is based on a couple of papers in collaboration with my former PhD advisor, Jorge Portoles, and with Andrea Lamy, who obtained his PhD with advised by both of us. And the first paper deals with lepton flavor violating semileptonic tau decays. This is this one here. And the second one with lepton flavor violating Higgs decays. So for the second one, you can just look anything in the reference. But for the first one, we made an improved updated analysis taking advantage of these proceedings that correspond mostly to the things I'll be showing here for this tau lepton flavor violating part. Okay, so having said that, I move. So there's some delay. So I move to the motivation. Of course, after the discovery of neutrino oscillation, only this flavor violation is not measured yet in charged lepton sector. In the minimally extended standard model with 100 neutrinos, signal is non-vanishing. You can see branching ratio at the level of 10 to the minus 54, but clearly unmeasurable. So anything you measure is clearly a signal of new physics in this type of processes, like mu to gamma, for instance. Experimental effort is really to be admired, and then the upper limit is at the level of 10 to the, minus 13 with very recent improvement here in this particular specific channel. Of course, searches do not restrict to this particular decay channel, and the hunt of new physics in lepton flavor violation is a global effort in the collaborations and also in the decay channels involved. So in addition to this mu to gamma, also mu to three electrons, that is electron and electron-positron pair, is searched for. Also of great interest are processes of muon to electron conversion in nuclei. And even in heavy meson decays, one can search for these processes, like at LHCb, for instance. And here I'll be mostly concerned, as I told you, in semileptonic lepton flavor violating tau decays that should be at reach at Bell 2 particularly. And also these Higgs lepton flavor violating decays that have attracted a lot of attention recently, and they are ATLAS and CMS are the ones trying to see this signal, or at least to improve the bounds on that. Okay, so that's as far as the motivation for lepton flow violation. Then I go to the motivation for the for this particular new physics model, that is Simplest Little Higgs model. This is just recalling the old idea of composite Higgs models that dates back more than 30 years, as you can see here. And the general idea is to understand the Higgs lightness as a result of it being a kind of pseudo-Goldstone boson, or like a kind of pion in this sector. That's the main idea. So then in this class of models, there is a scale of compositeness that is called F. There is a hopefully a strong hierarchy between the electroweak and this compositeness scale, so that the ratio of B over F is small enough, and then a perturbative expansion converges quite fast. And then Higgs potential is entirely or partly radioactively generated. These are general characteristics of these little Higgs models. Then, in particular case, Higgs mass is loop level generated. And then one has specific signatures of the model, as they are the appearance of little particles with masses of order of this compositeness scale for F. So then it should be a few TeVs, right, for them. And everything is arranged in such a way that the quadratic, the diverging contributions to the Higgs mass are cancelled in the way that the model is devised. That's the idea. Then, of course, ultraviolet completion of the model is expected at some scale that we can roughly estimate at 4 pi times F. So this should be at least some 10 TeV and can be a bit higher. So you expect some new particles at few TeVs, and then a more general theory at maybe 10, 20 TeVs or a bit higher. Okay, then there are two types of little Higgs models. There are product group models, excuse me, where you have the electroweak gauge group and you have n copies of that, right? In this case, you need T parity to really solve the little hierarchy problem on the Higgs mass. In our case, on the contrary, this is the simplest among the simple group models that are SUn times U1. So in our case, we just have SU3, you know, that's the simplest solution. This is the simplest little Higgs model. And in this case, you don't need to restore to any ad hoc symmetry like it is, for instance, T parity. In this case, you can get this kind of solution to little hierarchy problem without any additional symmetry. Okay, so that's the motivation for simple little Higgs model. And then if I go a bit more into the detail, I told you that here we don't need any kind of additional symmetry. That's in principle nice. And since it is the simplest option, so the electroweak group arises from the breakdown of just SU3 times U1. In this way, we need to enlarge the SU2L doublets to SU3L triplets and corresponding R singlets. These new particles are highlighted with these red boxes that you can see here. So as you can see, we need this kind of heavy neutrinos, this NK here. And these are very important because these are the ones that in fact drive the lepton flare violation. This NK here, these heavy neutrinos. This is the corresponding singlet. And as you can see, the issue here is not to explain neutrino masses. So no, for instance, no red-handed neutrino is added. Okay. Then for the quarks, there is some freedom, and one can choose an embedding that is anomaly free already. Or instead, one can delay the anomaly cancellation to the more UV complete theory. In our case, we follow this anomaly free embedding, but that's just a choice. So, okay, and in this case, the additional quarks that are here are this capital D, capital S, capital T that you can see here for the left-handed components of the triplet and the corresponding right-handed partners, okay? Then you can search for deviations from standard model induced by this simplest little Higgs model. For instance, you can compare the rates of H to CC star to the standard model expectation, and this is what you have in these plots here. So you see the one that is this line here, And then you see the spread of the points in this kind of models. For instance, this is on the upper part, these are little Higgs. On the down part, these are simplest little Higgs. So you can see that generally there is more spread in simplest little Higgs models. So larger deviations could be expected. In addition to this, the data points are seen also here. This is ATLAS, this is CMS. For this particular ratio that I'm speaking about, you see that they are well compatible with one and with still large errors. And of course, a big portion of the parameter space of the model is in agreement with these results, right? There are more comparisons in my additional material, and you can look there, for instance, for H2 gamma gamma compared to the standard model result and all these kind of things. But in general, I mean, the model is naturally in good agreement with the current measurements on Higgs physics, okay? Then I'll go to explain a little bit more in detail how the model works. So we need two complex scalar fields. There are triplets under SU3. These are these phi1 and phi2 here. And then you need these two because you need to have two breakings of the symmetry. You need to have a global breaking and also a breaking of a local gauge symmetry. So this is why you need at least these two complex scalar fields. So the basic mechanism of the symmetry breaking is summarized here. So you have two copies of the group, and then only the diagonal part is gauged, right? So there is the breaking of the global symmetry on the one hand, and as a result of this, you get the well-known Higgs degrees of freedom, and in addition, this a singlet, this eta that could play some role in, for instance, in dark matter, and this is discussed in these references here. And then, of course, yeah, at lower scale, this undergoes electroweak symmetry breaking and is the well-known standard model. So this as far as the global symmetry is concerned. Then in addition, you have the breaking of the local gauge symmetry, and as a result of this breaking, then you get, so you're breaking five generators, so you get five additional massive gauge bosons. There are these heavy copies of the W and C bosons that are in red here. And then this additional boson that doesn't play any role in our study. Okay, so the most important things here are these heavy gauge bosons, the W prime Z prime, and also it is of overall importance this heavy neutrinos that we get here, because with this we have the lepton flare violating effects we are discussing. Okay, so I think that's enough for the introduction of the model. Then I go to discuss the phenomenology, right? So in the first part, I'll be talking about this semileptonic lepton flare violating tau decays. And as I said, the analysis in the paper is updated in these proceedings of the tau 16 conference. Okay, so again, I'd like to stress how impressive the experimental effort has been in the last year. So from Clio to the B-factories, we have had an improvement of some two orders of magnitude in the main decay mode. So lepton into another lepton and photon, lepton into another lepton and pseudoscalar, or instead of the pseudoscalar, a scalar, a vector. And we have also the surges of a lepton into three leptons, as I discussed. And you can see the different points depending on the mode. Generally, two orders of magnitude of improvement since Clio to Bobard and Bell. We will have up to two orders of magnitude further improvement from Bell 2, right, as it starts acquiring data. So up to 10 to the minus 10, if we are lucky enough, it can be probed with this facility. Then it's exciting times to probe lepton flare violation there. Then we notice that there's been some good amount of activity in lepton to a lepton and a photon, or lepton to a lepton and a lepton anti-lepton pair from the virtual photon. So there's been some activity. But on the contrary, for this semileptonic decays, where you have in addition, for instance, a pseudoscalar, it can be a pion, an eta, for instance, scalars, vectors, then there's quite much less activity. And we could find only basically these references here. And so then some analysis in supersymmetry, in little Higgs model with the parity recently. and 3C1 models, effective field theory. But in this sense, we wanted to fill the gap in other little Higgs models for this analysis. That was also our motivation. Then I'll be a bit quick on the calculational details of the model. Here I'm including the one loop diagram. So these are photon C or C prime mediated diagrams. I'm always omitting the hadronization of this photon C to C to C prime or C prime going to QQ bar. And this hadronizes and gives you the mesons that you have in final state. But this I am omitting just for space. Okay, so you should see here QQ bar and then hadronizing, right? So here, everywhere. Okay, we have employed unitarity gates, and then in this way you only have physical particles appearing everywhere. Also, the cancellation of divergence is a bit more involved, but on the other hand, this is good because then you have a more strict check of the calculations. Okay, so these are the diagrams mediated by the photon, and as you can see in all of them, the important thing is to have this some that is driving the lepton flare violation, no, in this tau to mu transition. Okay, and then you have the couplings with the Ws, with the W primes, and also self-energy type of diagrams. Yeah. Another thing that is important to note is that I'm always including muon, but nothing changes if I replace the muon by an electron. No? There's lepton universality in all the couplings here, so for definiteness I'm restricting to muon, but it's the same for electron. And also the kinematics is almost the same, so no difference for them. Okay, so that's for photon-mediated diagrams. Then here, on this part of this slide, I'm including the set and C-prime mediated diagrams. You see there's a bit more richness here in the diagrams, and that's because of the different diagrams that you can have with one light neutrino or without light neutrinos, essentially, in this kind of diagrams, okay? These are the CNC prime mediated contributions. Then in addition to this, you have a box type of contributions, as you can see here. Then you have W's or W primes here, and then you have these quarks here are included, because otherwise it's a bit confusing the diagram as opposed to all the other diagrams when I'm not including the QQ bar that later hadronizes to give you the mesons in the final state. Okay. And here one particular thing about the unitarity gauge. I'm sorry. One particular thing about the unitarity gauge is that the cancellation of divergences is a bit subtle, because as opposed to that of Feynman gauge here. The divergence is cancelled between the sum of all penguin and self-energy type diagrams with the divergences coming from the box diagram. So the cancellation is not independent, but still, as I said, this is a nice check that everything agrees. Okay, so these are the diagrams that we are considering. Then, okay. Okay, there's some delay. Okay, now, so I already said about this cancellation of divergences. Then, as I mentioned at the beginning, we hope that the ratio between the electroweak and composite scale is small enough so that the perturbative expansion converges quickly. And in this scenario, you can organize the perturbative expansion in this way. So first contribution is of order to the matrix element. Is of order b squared over f squared, then there are corrections at the next order, but these are clearly smaller than this one, so we can throw them away safely. Then another approximation in the propagators, we can expand, because the scale of external momenta is always at most given by the tau mass, okay, and the tau mass is much smaller than the heavy particles in the loop, like the W prime, and the heavy neutrinos. Okay, so we can make this expansion and again throw terms that are suppressed by these external momentum scales over heavy particle scales in the loop. In addition to this, of course, we can put light neutrino masses to zero, also muon, even more electron, and light quark masses to zero. And as I said, once we have made this expansion, we can throw consistently away all these ratios that are small. Okay. And yeah, I also mentioned that external momenta can be set to zero in the computation of boxes based on the same argument I've been discussing. Okay, so these are the approximations for the for our computation. And then we get the results for the amplitudes. For instance, this is for the photon-mediated amplitude. And then we have a couple of four factors in each of the structures, right? So this is the dipole-like term. This is the one going with the charge. And then you have left and right four factors in each of them, right? I note that we organize the computation in such a way that we have explicit factor of E squared here. And then we make also explicit the expansion. So that's the leading term, that the only one we're keeping. That is of order b squared over f squared, as I mentioned. Also, we have the separation of the four factors because of heavy particle masses for half of them. Then only the other half are important. And in them, we have made explicit again the other separation that is given by this alpha weak as the ratio of alpha over the sine squared of the weak angle. And then what else remains? So the dependencies are given in terms of this chi j that you can see here. Chi j being the ratio between neutrino, heavy neutrino mass j over w prime mass, everything squared. Okay, so these are two of the little particles. So these are in principle of order of the same order for the TdV. Then these ratios of order one, okay, for the counting. And then the only other important thing that remains is this delta nu here. Delta nu here is basically the inverse of F tangent beta. Okay, and this is giving you the mixing in the neutrino sector between light and heavy neutrinos. And as you see, it depends on F tangent beta. This means that in fact these two quantities, F and tangent beta, are not independent in the model. So there's a strong correlation between them. That's important. Okay, so that was the photon. For the other contribution, I won't be giving that much details. Okay, so basic things you can see already in the photon contribution. So some four factors vanish because they are suppressed by heavy particle masses in the loop. And for the others, we make explicit the suppression in the expansion of or in ratio of the electro weak scale of the over the composite scale. And then there are also the electro weak suppression factors here clearly noted. And then the other important things in the model are this ratio between little particle masses. Okay, so heavy neutrinos driving the lepton flow violation and the W prime in this case, and this delta nu that is inversely proportional to F tangent beta. Okay, so now I go to the other contribution with much less details. Then again, for the C and C prime, we make explicit some of the suppressions in this G here, and then we have again four factors. Okay. So once more, this one with the subindex R here and here are suppressed at least as m tau squared over mc squared, so we can safely neglect them. And for the other two, you have the expressions in the additional material, and again, the expansion is of the same kind I discussed already for the photon contribution. I note here in this set and C prime contribution the appearance of these coefficients set L, set R, set prime L, set prime R. So that again include or hide, let's say, some suppression in electroweak factor. Okay, and in addition to this, you can have the dependence on the weak angle and on the charges of the external quarks involved. Okay, the electric charges. But these are quite straightforward to obtain these factors. Okay. Then it remains only the box contributions. And we write these contributions in this way you can see here. So again, explicit the suppression in alpha weak. And then there are terms that go with the log of this quantity kij that I told you is order one. And then others that are going as log delta, where delta is again an order one quantity, is the ratio between one of these new heavy quarks and the W prime masses square. And then we have a part that is log independent. Okay, this one here. You can find the expressions for all of them in the additional material. The expansion is made in the same way as before. Okay, again, I note this correlation between F and tangent beta that you can see here. That's important. And one thing I'd like to mention is that box contribution turned out to be relevant. Okay, You may guess that in channels with only one pseudoscalar meson, because in this case, because of C parity, the photon contributions are forbidden. Then you may guess, okay, so in the case with just one pseudoscalar, box contribution may be important. But even in the cases with two pseudoscalars, or what is equivalent with a vector, this turn out to be important. Okay, and that's a particular feature that is relevant and that I like to highlight in this simple little Higgs model. Okay. Okay, then I move to the hadronization. So as I told you, for instance, if I come back here, we have some quark bilinear here that needs to be hadronized, right? So this is, I mean, this is for the box contribution, but it's basically the same also for the photon C and C prime mediated contribution. Then how do we do the hadronization? How do we connect this at the quark level? Sorry. At the quark level with the mesons that we have in the experiment. So this hadronization is driven by low energy QCD properties. So in this sense, we write this in terms of the flavor currents. And then we proceed to the hadronization respecting the known limits of low energy QCD. So chiral symmetry, then dispersion relations allow you to automatically automatically include general axiomatic field theory properties like unitarity, analyticity, grossing symmetry. Then in addition, you make sure that the right QCD asymptotic behavior is fulfilled, namely Brosky-Lepage behavior for our factors. And even more, I mean, apart from all this theoretical machinery, it's good that for the four factors of interest, so for instance, two pions, no, vector current to two pions, we have very accurate data. So then we can use them to refine the theoretical approach and particularly to fix the subtraction constants of the dispersion relations. Okay? In this way, we have a very controlled framework to hadronize the quark bilinears into the mesons and vectors that we are measuring. Okay. Then, for the case with just one pseudoscalar, so tau to a muon or an electron, and then a pseudoscalar, that is a pi zero, eta, or eta prime meson, then you make the algebra, and it's very easy. Everything depends on the pseudoscalar decay constant, and then in addition to this, at most, in the eta prime mixing angle that you can see here. Okay, but that's quite easy, and then you have, for instance, the box functions here and trivial factors of the weak angle. Okay, in this case, in this way, you can treat all of them on the same footing. Okay, then I move to the decays into two pseudoscalars. Then the hadronization of the quark bilinear current is straightforward, and apart from the Lorentz structure, it gives you the well-known two meson vector four factor. Okay, and as I said, for this we have very accurate data. It's been widely studied, so it's very 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 well under control. You can see the expression, so again, in additional material of the talk. And I emphasize we are including all these known theoretical tools and getting advantage of the very accurate data in these decay modes. Okay, so then it's not that clear how to proceed in the case where you are talking about tau to a muon and a vector, namely a rho or a phi. In this case, you need to specify what do you understand as a vector. And then what is close to the experimental situation is to, and also it's reasonable from the theoretical point of view, is consistent, is to say that a rho is in fact a pi plus pi minus around the pole mass and width values of the rho. Okay, and this is what you can see in these expressions here. Okay, so it's peak at the rho mass, and then it takes into account the width. And this is a rho. And you can vary a bit the definition here, but basically results do not change much, okay? And even more in the case of the phi, because the phi is quite narrow, okay? So you do it, including the different Keon and Tikeon contribution, and that's how you make contact between the theoretical computations and the experimental measurements, okay? So then we can go to the predictions. We also benefit from previous work done on lepton flare violation in the simplest little Higgs model. This is done in this reference in blue here, the Lagley and Jenkins. And they studied thoroughly mu 2 e gamma, mu 2 3 electrons, and mu 2 electron conversion in nuclei. Okay. Of this analysis, they get a bound on, as I told you, F tangent beta, that's correlated, so it should be at least 3.5 TeV, let's say. And then again, delta nu is not independent, you can look here. And they made a very complete study of the allowed heavy neutrino mass hierarchies, okay? In this paper, they took the simplified case where only two heavy neutrinos matter, okay? So that's kind of gym-like. So for instance, you can understand that the mixing matrix for these heavy neutrinos is almost unitary in the two times two sector. So the third one is almost decoupled in practice. That's what they look at. And the reasonable bounds on the model parameters that they took were F between 2 and 10 TeV, tangent beta between 1 and 10. And this relation for the heavy quarks involved also making contact with this delta nu parameter here. Okay, and this results in fact in small mixing for all these Qs. And that makes everything consistent in an easier way with all precision data in meson physics, okay, to make it short. Okay, so we took advantage, as I said, of these studies, and then we looked to the semileptonic lepton flare violating tau decays that are written here, and also I will tell you later about that, to the Higgs lepton flare violating decays. And it's important to emphasize that every time we are taking all low energy constraints into account. Okay, so if we throw a point, if we scan in the parameter space and we get something that is inconsistent with one of the low energy constraints, then we throw this point out. Okay. Okay. So then I go to the plots. Here you can see in this part these are the different tau lepton flare violating processes considered. The experimental bounds for the case with a muon in this column and for the case with an electron in this column, and these are in units of 10 to the minus 8 at 90% confidence level, as it's written here. Okay, and then you can see in this plot we are scattering the model the model parameter values for reasonable values of them. And you see that in general, you may be in conflict with some of the low energy constraints. So here in the x-axis, we have tau to mu gamma, in the y-axis, we have mu to e gamma. And we see that some portion of the plots go outside of the experimental upper bounds that are represented by these red lines that you can see. So these red lines correspond to the upper limit that you can read in this table here. So you see that it's important to take into account the low energy constraints, because otherwise you can get in conflict with data. Here I am taking, to begin with, the simplified scenario with only two effective heavy neutrinos, okay? Now I'm plotting a branching ratio of tau to mu in a pair of pions with this upper limit, 2.1 times to the minus 8, versus the branching ratio for mu to e gamma. Then the x-axis is cut here at the upper limit of mu 2 e gamma, okay? So all the points to the right of the plot are cut. Then all plots here are consistent with mu 2 e gamma, and we see that being consistent with mu 2 e gamma automatically brings consistency with the upper limit in tau to mu in a pair of pions, okay? Because the upper limit would be 10 to the minus 8, and you can hardly get points above 10 to the minus 13, okay? You can see here, in this two heavy neutrino scenario, okay? Now the same for tau to mu pi naught versus mu to e gamma. So if you are not violating the mu to e gamma constraint, then automatically again, you are in agreement with the upper bound tau to mu and pi naught, okay? For this two heavy neutrino scenario, okay? Now I go to examine the correlation between tau to mu and pi naught and tau to mu pi plus pi minus. You see that the correlation is striking, and even more if you remember that the main production mechanism is different in both cases, because in mu in this one here, tau to mu pi plus pi minus, this here is dominated by the photon contribution, while here in mu to pi naught, this is forbidden by symmetries. So it should be dominated by the box. then in principle it's difficult to see to guess at first sight this correlation, but it is a result of the hadronization mechanism, okay, and this is explained in the paper. So in the end, this correlation is understood, but it's not evident at first sight, okay. Now in the next plot, now I'm going to the three heavy neutrino scenario. Of course, here you have more freedom. We have restricted it a bit because we neglected the phase that could be here, and just to have one less free parameter, but you can of course do that, and then you can have a bit larger branching ratios, for instance, using this parameter. But in this scenario now, we see that contrary to the previous one, we can be in agreement with mu to gamma. All these points are in agreement with mu to gamma, and sometimes it's a bit hard, but you can still violate the upper bound on tau to mu and a pair of primes. Okay, so in this case, this can happen. This doesn't appear to be the case for mu to and pi naught. Okay, because here if you are in accord with the upper limit in mu to gamma, then you still are so some 2 to 3 orders of magnitude below the upper bound on tau to mu pi. Okay. So in the model, even in the three heavy neutrino scenario, it's hard to get sizable signals in tau to mu pi naught, but not on tau to mu and a pair of pi's. Okay, so here it's more promising for detection in this sense. Okay. Okay. Now I go to plot the branching ratios as function of the model parameters. Okay. And now before in the previous plots, I was including here branching ratios on the axis, okay, directly branching ratios. Now it's not the case. Now everything is written with respect to the upper limit. Okay, so here really that's some point in the parameter space that happened to be very low. So you see it's much below the upper limit. And here you see that green line is set contribution, blue line is set prime contribution. This is logarithmic scale. So C and C prime contributions are negligible. So everything, absolutely everything in tau to mu pi comes from the box contribution. I told you, I repeat, that photon contribution is forbidden. So here, everything is box. Now, for tau to mu and pair of pions, again, set and set prime contributions are negligible, as you can see here. And now there is some strong interference between photon and box contribution. So these are the pair of lines here in green and red colors. And you see that as a result of this interference, you are in practice losing a factor of, let's say, five, in the overall result. Okay, so this interference brings results down. Okay. Now I am including for some specific point in the model parameter space, I am comparing the branching ratios that you can get for the different modes. And confirming earlier expectations, we see that those that get the higher rates, pair of pions and the closely related mu to rho. So these are the two that we can see here. And these are always at least an order of magnitude larger than mu to pi naught, for instance, and also even more larger than the others. Okay, so most promising for detection are mu to pi plus pi minus and mu to rho. Of course, apart from mu to gamma and tau to mu gamma and mu to conversion in nuclei, but these were studied previously. Okay. So here, from the semileptonic lepton flow violating decays, the most promising ones are mu to a pair of pions and mu to rho. Okay. Then I was plotting previously always the graph of the compositeness scale. Now I'm plotting them against tangent beta, and here the behavior for large tangent beta is quite monotonous. On the contrary, at low values of tangent beta, there is some mark deep around 2. Remember, this scale is logarithmic, so you can lose here more than an order of magnitude from varying a tangent beta factor of 2, no, here. Okay, so if tangent beta happens to be around here, then it's even more difficult to see any signal within this model. These are the again branching ratios plotted as a function of the mixing angle between the two heavy neutrinos. Okay, that's this theta here. I recall you in this simplified two heavy neutrino scenario, so everything is given in this sector only in terms of this angle. And of course, it couldn't be the other way. The behavior is quite monotonous. Okay, yeah, there's just a consistency check, let's say. So I go for the next plot, and now I'm representing the branching ratios with respect to the upper limits, I recall, versus the mass of the lightest of these heavy neutrinos, okay? And here there are two different scenarios, okay? There is a case with where these two heavy neutrinos, N1 and N2, are almost degenerate. And in this case, the gym-like mechanism of cancellation acts more efficiently. So then the branching ratios are lower. And then if there is quite some hierarchy between these two light heavy neutrinos, this N1 and N2, then this cancellation mechanism acts less effectively. Okay, so then now first, this is large splitting case. So in large splitting case, the branching ratios are larger than in the case with small splitting case, as you can see. So two orders of magnitude are lost from here to here because of this cancellation mechanism that acts more effectively in the case where there is small splitting between N1 and N2. Okay, but this is in agreement with expectations. Okay, you could expect that. It's just another consistency observation. Okay, now we go to 3D plots. So here you can, for instance, compare the behavior in F and the behavior in tangent beta. And you can, in this plot, you can see again this correlation in these two. No, so you cannot have simultaneously F and tangent beta large. No, so that's why you are having these extreme colors here and here. No, when one is large, the other one is small. But this we already knew from the dependence of delta nu. Okay. Now this is more monotonous on F and sine 2 theta. So branching ratios are large when sine 2 theta is large, and on F only there is this dip around 2 TeV, but for the rest is quite smooth in this region here. Okay. And again, we don't learn basically anything else new from these plots in F and the mass of the lightest among the heavy neutrinos, if we remember what we have learned about this cancellation mechanism. So no further information is got from these plots here, right? If provided this gym-like cancellation mechanism is understood. Okay, so with this, I would go to lepton flare violating Higgs decays, and I'll be a bit shorter on this part. So quite a long time ago, some 25 years, Higgs to tau mu was proposed as a promising channel to discover flavor violation of charged leptons. And even in some cases, it was proposed as one of the first decay channels of the Higgs that could be detected, right? And the interest on this decay mode has been kept very, very intense over the years, okay? It was even renewed and further increased with the improved limits on these lepton flare violating decays obtained by the refactories, but above all, the really good trigger for renewing this interest was the 2015 CMS hint. So as you know, they came up with this number, so 0.84 with an error of basically 0.4%, so which represented an upper bound of 1.5% at 95% confidence level. So it was a bit above 2 sigma, right? So this increased a lot the activity in this area. People were very excited. But just a bit later on, ATLAS didn't confirm this apparent hint from CMS, and their upper limit was basically in agreement with this one from CMS. And sadly, let me say, CMS updated the result. And now it appeared that what happened was a downward fluctuation. And you see here the central negative value with an error, of course, consistent with zero. But all in all, the hint for a signal has gone below 2 sigmas, right? And we wait for the update for ATLAS. But it may be that it goes even farther down. But for the moment, let us consider the Higgs to tau mu. Maybe not at 1%, but still at a sizable, measurable level at LHC. Okay, that's the motivation to keep doing these studies. So within this simplest little Higgs model, these are the one-loop diagrams. You see W and W-cam mediated diagrams. Again, the heavy neutrino is driving the lepton flare violation, as you can see here or here. This diagram, you can also have it with this WW prime self-energy type of contribution in this leg. But since you will have, I mean, if you have the tau, okay, the tau mass is not that small, but if you have a muon or electron, this type of contribution will be suppressed by the muon or electron mass, so you can forget about this contribution. And we have also this kind of contributions with heavy and light neutrinos at the same time, as you can see here. Now, the appearance of the Higgs mass brings you a richer scale, so we can have scales of order 1, as KG before, and these are the ratio between the heavy neutrino, between the heavy neutrino masses and W prime square, as you can see here, but also between W and Higgs mass square. Okay, this is also of the same order of this one. So these are the order 1 scales in the problem. And now this small scales that were defined in the problem before as omega, so the ratio between W and W prime mass square. And now we can form some ratios that are also of this order omega, that is order b square over f square, that is much smaller than 1, as you can see here. Okay, so that's the way we organize the computation. And we have also considered it both in the two effective heavy neutrino scenario and also in the general three heavy neutrino case, in the same way I explained before. Okay, so then we organize the amplitudes in this way. We have the overall dependence on the tau neutrino mass, and this immediately tells you that if you are considering Higgs to mu an electron, the suppression is quite strong. Okay, so in principle you expect a measurable signal, if any, only in Higgs to tau muon or Higgs to tau electron, but not in Higgs to mu electron. Okay, this should be very, very suppressed. And then we have again contributions that go log type and non-log type here. So again, we have the dependence on this delta nu that is inversely correlated to F tangent beta, I recall. And then we have this dependence on the ratio that is order 1, Kij here, and then also on tangent beta, on the wind mixing angle, as before, okay? Okay, so then with this, I recall the way we are introducing the three heavy neutrino scenario without any phase here, any CP violating phase here, just for simplicity. And in the amplitude, it is very easy to go from the two heavy neutrino to the three heavy neutrino case, because in the two heavy neutrino, as I told you, everything is multiplied by this mixing angle in the heavy neutrino sector, and then you have these ratios only of log chi 1 over chi 2, and then non-logarithmic pieces depending on chi 1 and chi 2. But then this just changes from this dependence here to the general dependence on the mixing matrix coefficients that are multiplied here. And then you also have gained this dependence on omega. Omega, I recall, is the small scale. So in principle, you notice that you can have larger signals for the three heavy neutrino scenario because two things. No? One, because you have more parameters, this gives you more freedom. And also because you can have, you can gain a moderately larger log here. No, because this is order 1 and this is small scale. Okay, so these are the two facts that contribute to have larger branching ratios in the three heavy neutrino scenario. Okay, that's the important thing. Then I go to the plots. So always in this part of the talk, I'm showing on the left-hand side the results obtained with in the effective two heavy neutrino scenario. On the right-hand side, I'm presenting the results in the more general three heavy neutrino case, okay, and as you and as I reasoned before, you observe this enhancement in the general case. So you see that some 5 to 6 order of magnitudes are gained from going from the left to the right. Okay, that's what you expect. But still, the branching ratios are given in the percents here, and the red line represents the upper limit obtained by CMS. So then, I mean, if you compare it, you are well below. So no chance for detection. So at least 7 orders of magnitude, even in this case here, okay? Now that was the dependence of the branching ratios on F, that is quite monotonous, as you can appreciate here. Now that's the dependence on the lightest among the heavy neutrino masses. It's quite smooth, and once more, you get very small, unmeasurable branching ratios at the late C. So this is a characteristic of the little Higgs models. Okay, I will make this point stronger later on. Now the dependencies on tangent beta, again, you seem to observe some kind of dip here, less marked than before, but you seem to observe it. But still, you are very, very low compared to the current experimental bound and even to the observability region at LHC that should be here. So you can't observe Higgs lepton flare violating decays according to the simplest little Higgs model. Okay. And finally, here branching ratios are plotted versus the only angle given the mixing in the two heavy neutrino scenario, and versus the maximum of the mixing that you can get in the three heavy neutrino scenario. Okay. The conclusions are in agreement with the previously shown plots. Okay. Finally, here I'm comparing the branching ratio of mu to gamma versus the branching ratio of Higgs to tau mu. Again, this is the upper limit obtained by CMS at 95% confidence level. And once more, this axis is cut here at the upper limit of mu to gamma. Okay, so if you are in the plot, you are in agreement with mu to gamma. And you see that provided this agreement happens, there's no way to be close to the CMS upper limit. So even in the three heavy neutrino scenario, when we are getting larger rates, we are at least four to five orders of magnitude below the upper limit. Okay. And this is to be a general characteristics of little Higgs model, because in a recent study of little Higgs model with T-parity that I'm quoting here, again, this observation is confirmed. So if you are in agreement with the low energy limits, then you cannot explain within this class of models lepton flare violating Higgs decays at a rate close to 1%. Okay, it should be much less. So at most 10 to the minus 6 here. Okay, then sadly unobservable at the LHC. Okay. So with this I go to the conclusions. So theoretically, little Higgs models, particularly simplest little Higgs models, that is the one I've been talking about, seem to be elegant candidates to understand why the Higgs is so light, okay? And they respect all experimental bounds. So I showed you Higgs to CZ prime, but also Higgs to a couple of photons. Another Higgs observables are in agreement with a very, very good portion of this little Higgs model parameter space. Okay, so that's one thing. Then we have explored that, and we see that the lepton flare violating signals predicted by this class of models are very, very small in the case of semileptonic tau decays, and even more in the case of lepton flare violating Higgs decays. So according to these models, there is no hope to observe lepton flare violating Higgs decays at LHC. On the contrary, if these models happen to be right, then lepton flare violating detection is not impossible. It would be easier in the decays mu to gamma, tau to mu gamma, lepton to three leptons, muon to electron conversion in nuclei. And then among the processes we are discussing here, it could be detected in tau to muon or electron in a pair of pions, or tau to muon in electron in a row. So that's the change from this study, okay? And I emphasize the easier it would be, the closer we are to the effective, to the three heavy neutrino scenario, okay? So if there is some kind of gene-like cancellation, then it would be even harder to detect these modes. So again, within little Higgs models, it's very, very hard to understand any measurable signal in at LHC. But on the contrary, in tau to mu gamma, mu to gamma, lepton to three leptons, muon to electron conversion in nuclei, and also, and this was discussed at length in this talk, also in tau to muon or electron in a pair of pions, and in tau to muon and electron on a row, you can have easier detection if three heavy neutrinos are active within the model. Okay, and I think that's all for the moment from my side, and thanks for your attention.
Thank you very much, Pablo, for this very nice talk. I shall confess that it is completely new for me. I didn't knew too much about this little Higgs model. Okay, I have an echo. I don't know if it is only me, but well, now we are going to the questions. I don't know if any in the room has a question for Pablo. I can. Well, you can take the voice. Okay. Any question?
Hello, hello. Do you hear me? Okay.
Maybe no. Okay, somebody else can go ahead.
No, you go.
Okay. Thank you. two questions. I saw Paolo, very nice talk. By the way, it was very detailed. So I saw in one of your initial plots that you gave the branching ratio for tau mu gamma, and there was a line around the 10 to the minus 12, exactly right there. So I mean, the current bound on the branching ratio, I think it's of the order of 10 to the minus 8, is it? So is this what Bell expects to improve, to go down to 10 to the minus 12?
Yeah. In fact, yeah. Okay. So yeah. I didn't explain these lines correctly. So you are right. So this red line here, the one I'm pointing now, this corresponds to the upper limit on mu to the gamma. Okay. This one, the horizontal one corresponds to the upper limit, to the current upper limit on tau to mu to the gamma.
Yes.
Then my general practice is to be cutting the plots here in mu to the gamma at the current upper limit.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. So that was what I'm basically doing. And here, I didn't do this. I could have cut this one here, and that should be here, for instance. And I'm showing this value that is even a bit lower than 10 to the minus 12. That could be the most optimistic scenario for Belchu. I mean, with the complete statistics and with even reduced systematic effects in the detection. Yeah, but you are right that this is present and this should be future projection. So here, you are not getting out for this point. The points out will be here.
Yeah, yes, but so we can go down to 10 to the minus 12. I'm quite surprised. I expect 10 to the minus 9 or so. But okay, it's...
Yeah, it should be, I mean, from the statistics, it should be... it's a factor of 50 with Babar and Bell combined with the complete Bell 2 statistics. So it's two orders of magnitude with Bell, for instance, okay? Uh-huh. And then if you further improve on the systematic, depending on the detection mode, you can get a bit more. You can gain a bit more.
Okay.
So then you can go below 10 to the minus 10 for sure. I think maybe it would be more realistic to make it up one order of magnitude.
I see.
But that's probably too optimistic. Yeah, I agree.
Okay, fantastic. So there's another question. So you are considering, I mean, most of your heavy neutrinos are very heavy, right, of the order of the TeV. But every now and then you consider. I saw some plots that you were putting heavy neutrinos of the order of a couple hundred. A GeV. So yeah. Have you seen the possibility of directly producing them at collider experiments in that case and see if there's any correlation between that?
Yeah, in fact, okay, so first thing is that in principle, if you are very aggressive, you can take the PDG bound that comes from the absence of their observation in set decays. So then you can go down exactly to this point here, if you do that. But that's very aggressive. So in principle, the realistic region doesn't start here. It should start here. So for the two heavy neutrino scenario, we took a reference. I mean, the authors were, I'm sure, Depish, and I think I don't remember the other authors, but they consider collider signatures of this kind of heavy neutrinos in the two heavy neutrino case. So in the two heavy neutrino case, we took into account their constraints.
I see.
In the three heavy neutrino case, we couldn't find a reference that made this study, and we didn't do it. But I mean that's true. But we weren't pushing that much there to be sure that we were within the limits.
Okay. Okay. Cool. Thank you.
Thank you.
Any other question, comments, complaints about the presentations?
Oh, I have a question because before just Joel was giving yours. So regarding to this heavy neutrinos, Pablo, is it possible to make it to work with neutrino masses, to participate in mechanism for neutrino masses in this scenario? Or they are to
okay, so
if you're thinking whatever, but
I get the question. So one thing is that it is not one of the concerns of the model to explain neutrino masses, right? So from the beginning, they were worried about the hierarchy problem on the Higgs mass, and then the phenomenology has been explored, but the main concern was the Higgs mass value. Then you can do easy things like just having a recombinant neutrino, for instance, and then you get some mass, but again, you have the fine tuning problem with the specific value of the power. You could maybe do other things, but I mean, one thing is that these heavy neutrinos are not that heavy. So they could be as light as maybe 100 of GeV. And at most 1 TeV or a bit more. So then it's very difficult to make, I think, I'm not completely sure of that, but I think it's very difficult to make them part of an explanation of the light neutrino masses because they are very light compared to typical explanations of them. So, I mean, if you try this, probably the fine-tuning reappears and is not less than the original one. So then I don't think that it's very attractive from this point of view, but I must admit I haven't explored that.
Yeah. No, I understand. They are too light to give the pointer analysis of type one.
Yeah.
So another question that I was wondering, and because when you have this type of model and with this Z prime and W prime, you have any correction, for instance, to the G minus two of muon?
Yeah.
Extra phenomenology.
This question I've got almost every time I've spoken about this. Yeah, it's very natural. No. Yeah, because I mean, there's one of the few places where there seems to be still a deviation between theory and experiment, like the sizable left.
Yeah, exactly.
So we haven't done this, but we suspect that a general trend of this kind of models, or little thick models, that they use naturally small effects. In a sense, they were built to explain the likeness of the Higgs, and on the other hand, to give very small effects everywhere. So, for instance, in this D-2, you can have lepton flare violating coupling at both ends of the diagram, no? And then you can have a contribution to this D-2. But this kind of contribution, I'm sure, is very, very suppressed because it is the general trend of the model to give you very small branching ratios for all of this. So, summarizing, we haven't done it, but we are sure that the effect will be negligible compared to the difference between theory and experiment and to the errors on both of them.
Okay, so in the sense that the source of the deviation couldn't be related directly with this, should be in a bigger, with a larger part of the counter, something like that too.
Yeah, if you do not violate low energy constraints, then it's the same we have observed. It's analogous to what we have observed in Higgs lepton flare violating decays. You don't have enough freedom to give a sizable signal there.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So I don't know. I mean, I have other questions, but also I want to leave space for the rest to make questions.
Okay. I have a question because, you're saying that, your conclusion is that, there is a possibility to detect this kind of models in a lepton flavor violation, but I'm not sure, if we detect something, can be sure that then the Higgs is a composite state of particles, or there is other models that will predict the same? I mean, what will be the signature that you expect to...
Excellent. I would look to many different things. So, for instance, as you said here in this plot, it's not impossible that, if simple little Higgs model is right, that's speculative, but if this happened to be right, then we could measure, according to this plot, for instance, we could measure mu to e gamma or tau to mu pi plus pi minus. No? And then, this could be or not a signal of these little Higgs models. Then something that is quite specific from these models is this correlation. So if I measure one, then the other one is basically predicted. There is not that much freedom, especially in the higher end of this plot. So here the correlation is very, 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 very strict. So then if I expect to see something in tau to mu pi plus pi minus, and then not to see something very soon in tau to mu pi naught, because this is typically a bit suppressed with respect to the other. So then with more data, I would see tau to mu pi naught. And that's something. But then that's not enough. So I would need to look, if I go at the beginning, I would need to look more closely to the deviations in Higgs physics. Then this should be... There are some signatures of these deviations in the little Higgs models, in Higgs to CC prime, also in Higgs to a couple of photons. There are specific models related to this scalar that one has here. So if you don't discover this scalar, then a particle is missing in the model. So if you look for it, if you fix things from other observables and you conclude that this should be, at 30 GeV, and you don't discover it, then you falsify the model. No? So I would need to put all the pieces together in a sense.
Okay, thank you very much. Roberto have a question. Lino. Go ahead, Roberto, please.
Okay, the question is from Avelino, in fact.
Yeah.
So he's asking to you, your setup is very similar to the variant in 331 models, in which the third component of the leptonic SU3 left triplet is neutral. Therefore, do your results also apply to the both models?
So I think I didn't get the question. So
he said basically that your model is very similar to this 331 model, in which you have two SU3 two times one U1. So he's asking if he could apply your result in this framework.
Okay, so I am not at all an expert in 331 models, but my doubt is, in these models, because of this assumed Higgs compositeness, you have all observables expressed as ratios of these, no, of the electroweak and the compositeness case. And then this converges quickly. I'm not sure about this expansion parameter or similar expansion parameter in analogous way in the 331 models. So if that is the case, yes, I would expect that because of the symmetries in the gauge group. But I am not sure about this detail. So maybe results are further suppressed here because of the hierarchies that happen here. So here, this is related also to the corrections to the Higgs mass. So, F needs to be at least 2 TV, I said, probably 3. And I mean, that's also related to Higgs physics. And I don't know in 331 models if you have a similar restrictions entering. Also here you have this particular correlation between F and tangent beta. And I doubt if this happens in 331 models. So I am not at all an expert in 331 models, but I would have my doubts because of these two things I am mentioning. I don't know if this specific dependencies here and here and this correlation here are also shared by the 331 model. So I don't know if Abelino can shed more light on this.
Yeah, okay. I guess meanwhile we can wait if Abelino want to make a reply to your answer in the chat. But anyway, I have a question from my side because I guess I heard some, but I don't know if it is possible in the simplest little Higgs model, but usually also is a source of possible dark matter candidate. But
yeah,
when you include deep parity, I don't know, in this framework, you can also have some stable or long-lived particles that could take the role of dark matter.
Yeah, there is one.
They're also composite, higher state composite.
Yeah, you are absolutely right. There is one. So let me find this slide where this is commented. So it should be here. Okay. So from the breaking of the global symmetry, you get the Higgs degrees of freedom, and in addition, this scalar, this eta here. Mm-hmm. This eta could be a candidate for stable dark matter. And this is exploring in these references here. I mean, there is not any very recent reference, so I don't know to which extent this is updated, at least that I know of, any very recent reference. But at this time, this was examining this problem. And this data is the state that appears here. And this is the simplest little Higgs model. So one can explore the case to a pair of etas, or a set and an eta. So yeah, these are very interesting signatures. And as you said, then in the little Higgs model, you have the parity that is analogous to the parity in supersymmetry, and can explain why the lightest of the other particles under this symmetry can be the electric. Yeah, absolutely.
Mm-hmm. So, and I was wondering, which is the future for the experiment? After RAC and Bell 2, what is expected to be experiments to search for these kind of lepton flavor variation processes?
Okay, so
I don't know if the linear collider also is going to be looking for that, but
yeah, I don't know at all the prospects for the linear collider. I know that at the LHC they will keep having activity on here. I mean, that's a central part of the program for sure for the years to come, in which they will still be operating. And of course, for Bell 2, there will be a lot of years. And I mean, as far as I know, there will be great advances in mu to 3 leptons, mu to electron conversion in nuclei. So I mean, of course, besides this, that was more related to my talk. But in mu to 3 leptons, I'm immune to electron conversion in nuclei, I think that they will be improving the limits a lot. So that could be the frontier for killing models and or maybe finding something, hopefully.
Abelino just replied to your reply, and your answer, I mean. And he's saying, I would say, not sure, that at least qualitatively, it should be similar. One has the same vertices with Z prime and W prime. Of course, there might be quantitative differences due to the specific model relation. So
yeah, maybe this one, for instance. But yeah, in general, I agree. I would say he's right. Yeah.
Okay. Do we have more questions?
Yes, I have one.
Okay, go ahead, Nicolas.
Thank you. Actually, I had two. And since you were talking about this eta field and the right hand and the heavy neutrinos, how do these fields get mass? How are the mechanisms in which they get masses?
Okay. Yeah, okay, so I mean, for the standard model particles, it's this breaking of the symmetry that gives them mass. And then, as a result of the breaking of this this local part of the cross U1, then this 5-gauge boson gets mass. Okay, so this, for us, only W prime and Z prime are of importance, but this is what gives mass to them.
Okay, but how is configured the interactions in which the eta is present? I mean, for instance, is it present? Are there any interactions with the mass in between the massive eta and the neutrinos? I mean, the standard model neutrinos and the heavy neutrinos.
Okay, I must have something in my backup about this. Let me go to sleep. Okay, so not here. Okay, you see, this I already said, but you see here explicitly.
Okay.
Corrections to the standard model relations that are given in powers of B squared over F squared. That's a general term of the model. Okay, then here, in here you can see the mass of these heavy neutrinos, how it arises. So it's proportional again to F, so they are little particles, and it has this dependence on sine beta, and this lambda I that is free in the model, so you can okay.
And
as a result of the symmetry breaking, these particles get mass. And also here you see explicitly, I was talking about this delta nu arising in the mixing between the light and heavy neutrinos, and you can see it explicitly here.
Okay. So the eta field has no other, I didn't get whether it was a scalar or pseudo-scalar, but in the case it is a scalar, let's say. Yeah. Does it have a pseudo-scalar companion?
No, it doesn't.
Okay. Yeah. Okay. No, the point was trying to patch a neutrino mass mechanism. For instance, it would have been nice whether this field had a new pseudo-scalar companion in order to mix them up and give rise to a scotogenic kind mechanism.
Yeah, I see. Here it's only one degree of freedom that is this digital.
Yes, exactly. You need another additional degree of freedom in order to have a neutrino mass radiatively generated.
So, yeah, that possibility could be interesting, but
yes, it's both. I see. Thank you so much.
Thank you very much.
Okay, is any other question for Pablo? Okay, I see. No. And then, okay well, thank you very much, Pablo, for this very nice talk. It was very, very interesting to know about this model and the experimental signature. And well, we will see all together in 2 weeks I think it's Christmas. For the next webinar, I think this is the last webinar of this year. And well, thank you very much for being here, and to you all next episode.
Yeah, I would just like to say again thank you to you, Germán, and to all the Latin American webinars team. And it's a very, very nice initiative, and I encourage you to go on, because that's great. So congratulations.
Okay, thank you very much. Okay, goodbye.
Bye-bye.